This is the Voice of Freedom. Listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, we have been bombarded lately with a plethora of extraterrestrial alien claims, supposed abductions, phony government documents, a comet coming toward the Earth with a mysterious spaceship accompanying it, larger than the Earth itself, hollow, and sending out warning messages as it gets closer. And I could go on and on and on. What is going on? And who is bringing it about? And what is its purpose? Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be exploring some of the things that are being perpetrated upon us, and we're going to try to answer some of those questions, and some of those answers are just going to boggle your mind. Don't go away. I'll be right back. Seeing that certainly being thrust upon us from every quadrant. From politically correct thinking to the attack upon patriotism and militias. I mean, it's amazing what is going on. But this extraterrestrial crap, and it is crap, perpetrated by all of those little la-la-woo-woo people who run around in the ufology movement, and I know them all, ladies and gentlemen, because there was a time when I believed this stuff too, so I understand how you can fall into it. What you've got to understand is that you have to stop thinking with everything besides your brain and start using your brain and fall back out of it, because it's going to get you, it's going to bite you good. This stuff is dangerous. And when you begin to use the gray matter between your ears to question it and to check it out, it all falls to pieces like snow melts in your hand. There's absolutely no substance to it, no proof, no evidence. Only conjecture, lies, hoaxes, doctored photographs, outright fake photographs, and most of it can be directly connected to the mystery religions with no problem whatsoever. Go to some of these UFO conventions and shows and symposiums and just listen. That's all you got to do is listen. If you have any background in studying the symbology of the ancient mysteries and the so-called fraternal orders, this stuff falls apart right in front of your eyes. Let me just go over some of it with you. Nobody in the world was concerned about extraterrestrial life forms or flying saucers until World War II, when some of our pilots and other pilots reported seeing so-called Foo Fighters, which would fly up alongside of our bombers on their bombing missions and sort of accompany them for a while, during which time the electrical systems on the bombers would fail. They would have to abort their mission and go back to their home base, those that did not crash due to the failure of their electrical systems. And this was a big mystery, but nobody attributed it to extraterrestrial visitation or alien life forms or flying saucers or anything else. They thought it was a German secret weapon, and guess what, folks? It was. After the war, we recovered documents and technology that showed us that the Germans had perfected these remote-controlled craft to disable the electrical systems on our bombers by the propagation of a tremendous electromagnetic field. And that's who was using them, and that's what they did. And There was nothing any more mysterious about them than the fact that nobody had ever seen it before. We also discovered that the Nazi scientists and Hitler's super weapons program had developed flying disc-shaped craft. Most of them were propelled by turbine jet engines. And we recovered documentation, we recovered plans, we recovered pieces of the technology and brought it all back here with an awful lot of the scientists, some of whom went to the Soviet Union and others were taken to other countries by whoever happened to venture upon them first. And this technology was exploited in secret by the United States government, the government of Canada, Great Britain, probably Australia, and who knows who else. A couple of senators who were visiting the Soviet Union watched two of these disc-shaped craft take off from a Soviet military base and reported that to the United States government when they returned. Their report was classified secret. It's not classified anymore. I have a copy of their complete report. It tells us that the Soviet Union had also developed these disc-shaped flying craft. Nothing extraterrestrial about them, nothing alien about them. The only mystery was that nobody had ever seen them before. And since all governments denied any knowledge of this technology or of these craft, people began to look elsewhere for the answers. Sort of like having your television set fail in your living room, and instead of walking over to see if one of the children had unplugged the set from the wall, you go down and purchase a plane ticket and fly off to New York or London in order to try and snoop around and see what happened to your TV set. Must have been those dastardly Englishmen. See how silly it is, folks? The very idea, when you really begin to examine these things logically, the idea that we see something flying in our atmosphere and we don't know what it is, that it must have come from some star system millions of light years away, is ludicrous. It doesn't even begin to pass any kind of common sense test or any process of logic or reasoning whatsoever. If it's flying in our atmosphere, ladies and gentlemen, the absence of proof that it came from anywhere else, it belongs to this earth. Came from this earth, was built by somebody on this earth, or is a manifestation of some kind of law, of science that maybe we don't understand on this earth. You see, because there is no evidence anywhere, no one is in possession of any evidence of any kind whatsoever that extraterrestrial life exists anywhere in the universe, much less that is has ever visited this earth, if in fact it does exist. There is no evidence that anything that has seen or appeared or flown through or touched or been seen by anyone here on this earth has come here from any place else other than this earth, or was built any place other than this earth. No piece of physical evidence has ever been recovered that cannot be explained as being a technology that already exists on this earth, or a metallurgy that already exists on this earth and is of earthly origin. And that is the truth. And if you don't believe that, folks, some organizations and people have offered millions of dollars in reward to the first person who can ever present them with any proof of the existence of extraterrestrial life forms or extraterrestrial technology or extraterrestrial visitation or extraterrestrial origin of flying saucers or UFOs or anything else that you can imagine. Not one single person, including all of these people who assure you that they do have proof, have ever stepped forward to claim any of those awards or rewards whatsoever. because there isn't any proof. They don't have any proof. I watched one day, I watched these bullshit artists one day sitting in the desert of Nevada on this little platform built specially for Larry King, for the Larry King show, while he trooped across your television set, several of these so-called experts who have proof. We watched Stanton Friedman and many of these other people sit there and tell us about all the proof that they have that proves absolutely that extraterrestrial life exists and it is visiting this earth, but yet not one person presented, not one iota of any of that proof during that show or any other show or any lecture or any videotape or any radio interview in their history. They always have it. It always exists, but they never ever show it to you. Everything that they show you can be explained, is not of extraterrestrial origin, or is just outright provable hoaxes, lies. Fake photographs, phony documents supposedly obtained from the United States government, and on and on and on. Without reservation. I have studied this for many years. I have looked at everything that they say is proof. I have examined every document. And there just isn't any. It doesn't exist. So what is the purpose of all of this? What is it that they're trying to tell us? Well, ladies and gentlemen, when you have examined all of it, it fluctuates from extremes. You see, there is one element of it that tells us that we are terrible, terrible examples of citizens of the universe. That we are a despicable species that has sprung up on this earth, and that we are destroying each other, and we are destroying the earth, and we are destroying the environment, and we are a vicious, violent, war-making species, and that this somehow is disturbing the harmonics of the universe. And on some faraway star system, these extraterrestrials felt this disturbance in the space-time continuum and decided to come and save us from ourselves. These are the so-called benevolent aliens. They come to save us. And those of us who will not be saved, they will leave here to destroy ourselves and the earth, and they're going to lift up from the earth all the New Agers and the believers and the gentle people who are in the process of an evolutionary shift in consciousness. They call it a paradigm shift. And they will be taken somewhere else while we destroy ourselves, probably to the planet of the benevolent aliens, who will then treat them as kings and queens and gods and goddesses and all this other blithering blather that you hear. Ain't so, ain't gonna happen. Sort of like the fundamentalist invention of the rapture. That's not gonna happen either. But they are basically the same thing. Escapism is what it's called. And since the benevolent aliens are going to save me, I don't have to be involved in worldly things. I don't have to care about what Clinton does or Gaddafi does or Saddam Hussein or the Russians. I don't have to be concerned about what happens in Bosnia or even down the street from my house. Who cares if you get mugged? You are the bad, despicable people, and I'm going to be lifted up and I'm going to be saved. So none of this means anything to me. That's the general attitude of the people who believe in the benevolent space brothers are going to lift me up proposition, just like it is the attitude of Christians who believe they're going to be raptured. I wonder what's going to happen to the minds of these people when they find out that none of it is going to occur. They're going to be stuck here to solve their problems, and they're going to be subjected to whatever happens in this world because they're not going anywhere at all. And the other part of this benevolent space brother thing is that, the space aliens are very upset about the situation here, and while they're policy is normally not to interfere in the development of other species on planets outside of their own. They have seen that it's gone so far now that at some future date, they're going to intervene and destroy all of the bad people on the Earth, and the only people who will be left will be the people who have made this paradigm shift into the politically correct thinking attitude of the New World Order. They're going to give up all weapons. They're going to disarm. They're going to be meek and obey their leaders. And oh, guess who's propagating that? Oh, boy. Well, that's the benevolent alien side of this thing. There's another side. The other side is that these extraterrestrials are another whole species, or maybe several other species of extraterrestrials, aside from the benevolent space brothers, as they're called. They're not my brothers. Are here to suck our blood and steal our genetics and crossbreed with us and eat us and destroy us and take over the earth and take all of the minerals and wilderness timber, gold and silver and all of that stuff. And that they are secretly behind those in power who are evil and who rob and steal and lie and foment wars and all of those things. They're really being directed by these what are called negative aliens. They're negative. I don't know if it's minus one or minus 50. You know, I'd like to see, and they skip the zero. You know, in my estimation, they're all zero aliens, to tell you the truth, because none of them exist. It's all in your mind. It's the biggest blathering babble of crap I have ever seen in my life, and I have waded through all of it. There's not one corner of it that I have investigated, that I have not investigated. There's not one of these people that I have not looked into. Stanton T. Friedman, the nuclear physicist. Guess what, folks? We investigated his whole life and his employment. We can't find one single time in his life or any company or corporation or government agency that will ever admit that he worked for them in any capacity that involves nuclear physics whatsoever. Period. We can tell you without any doubt whatsoever that for the last 25 years he has never gone near a nuclear reactor. He has never gone near any employment having to do with nuclear physics whatsoever. In fact, his main occupation has been going around the country lecturing and speaking in front of groups for large fees, telling them all that he's a nuclear physicist. And I even have a copy of his curriculum vitae and all of the companies and corporations that he has claimed to work for. We have written them letters, ladies and gentlemen. They say they never heard of the guy. They have no record that he was ever employed by them or that he was ever a nuclear physicist for those companies or anything else. The ones that we can locate that he did work for say that, no, they're not involved in nuclear physics. They don't have any atomic reactors. They're not building atomic bombs. They don't mess with radioactive isotopes. And yes, Stanton T. Friedman was employed by them, but in none of those fields. So why does he claim to be a nuclear physicist? Well, simply, folks, because you have been brainwashed to believe someone who says he is a nuclear physicist. That's why, or at least that's what appears to be the reason. Now, if he was a nuclear physicist, or he ever worked as a nuclear physicist, I'm going to tell you right now, we have not been able to locate anybody who will admit to such a thing. And we've tried. We have tried. We've gone through his resume and his curriculum vitae, and we have contacted all of these people, and not one single one of them will tell us that Stanton T. Friedman ever worked for them in any capacity as a nuclear physicist. How about that? Isn't that something? Well, I think it's something. And he's just one. I mean, I can go through the whole the whole skedaddle, I can assure you. And probably will. Then there's the Philadelphia experiment, which never occurred, and people running around the country telling you that they were subjects of the Philadelphia experiment and traveled through time. Al Bielek is one of them. And many of you are falling all over these stories. You just love to hear them. And you lavish all the attention and money in your pockets on these people. The problem is, you see, there's nothing wrong with listening to a story and saying, hey, that's a great story, but when you believe it, with no substantiation whatsoever, it will not withhold its credibility with even the slightest, most amateurish investigation by anyone. It's blathering baloney. Without any doubt whatsoever, it is the most, well, I'll tell you what, it doesn't say much for the mentality of a large segment of the American population and of the population of the rest of the world who are all believers of this stuff. In fact, it portends a terrible future if that is the type of minds that are voting for politicians, that are determining the directions of corporations and companies and businesses, that are determining the social welfare of people, that are, well, in fact, if they're making any decisions about anything at all, we're in big trouble. Big, 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 big trouble. And I mean really big, 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 big trouble, because, folks, that is not the kind of people that you want.
What is it, this head that lives without a body? A monstrous thing that enslaves every woman, destroys every man who stares into its eyes. A thing that couldn't die.
Folks, listen to this. I got something here I want to give to you. I want to tell you about this because I think you need to know. So here we go. This is about the Philadelphia experiment. I want you to listen very carefully because I'm going to tell you the truth about it. And all you people have been running around spending all your money on lectures of people who supposedly took part in this and buying books that feed you all the blather of life that you never check out. Here's the story. Allegedly, in the fall of 1943, a United States Navy destroyer was made invisible and teleported from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania to Norfolk, Virginia, in an incident known as the Philadelphia Experiment. Records in the Operational Archives Branch of the Naval Historical Center have been repeatedly searched, ladies and gentlemen, by me and many, many other people. No documents have been located which confirm the event or any interest by the Navy in attempting such an achievement. Just never happened. There was, however, during the war, the development of degaussing. Degaussing were huge cables that were wrapped around inside the hull of the ship, both longitudinally and athwart ships, and tremendous electrical currents were put through these coils, and they're still in use on naval ships today, which created an electromagnetic field in order to neutralize the natural magnetic field of the ship so that the ship would not be blown up when it went through a minefield populated by magnetic mines. Now, I've always known about this because in the Navy I was a quartermaster. It was my job to set the degaussing coils. It was my job to notify the range when we entered or left harbor, the degaussing range, so that they could measure the magnetic field of the ship and then give us the proper settings which we could determine how to neutralize this magnetic field so that some crazy idiot somewhere could not plant magnetic mines which we would then run over and blow up our ship. Of course, we didn't want the Germans to know about this. And the original source of the so-called Philadelphia experiment may have been an Office of Naval Intelligence counterintelligence operation to make the Germans think we had developed something that would make ships invisible. And even though we couldn't, just the thought of such a thing would have sent them into convolutions of insanity. The ship involved in this so-called experiment was supposedly the USS Eldridge. We checked all the operational archives, all the ship logs, the deck log, the war diary from the Eldridge's commissioning on the 27th August 1943 at the New York Navy Yard through December 1943, and every record that we could find. And here's the description of the Eldridge's activities as summarized from the ship's war diary. After commissioning, the Eldridge remained in New York and in the Long Island Sound until 16 September, when it sailed to Bermuda. From 18 September, the ship was in the vicinity of Bermuda undergoing training and sea trials until the 15th of October, when the Eldridge left in a convoy for New York, where the convoy entered on 18 October. The Eldridge remained in New York Harbor until the 1st of November, when it was a part of the escort for convoy UGS-23, New York section. On the 2nd of November, the convoy entered Naval Operating Base Norfolk. On 3 November, Eldridge and convoy UGS-23 left for Casablanca, where it arrived on 22nd November. On the 29th of November, the Eldridge left as one of the escorts for convoy GUS-22 and arrived with the convoy on 17 December at New York Harbor. The Eldridge remained in New York on availability training and in Block Island Sound until the 31st of December, when it steamed to Norfolk with four other ships. During this time frame, Eldridge was never, ever, now listen to me, was never, ever in Philadelphia. The Eldridge's complete World War II action report and war diary coverage, including the remarks sections of the 1943 deck log, is available in microfilm, ladies and gentlemen. NRS-1978-26. That's NRS-1978-26. The cost of duplicate film is indicated on the fee schedule. If you write to them and ask for it, they'll send it to you. And all you have to do is fill out the order form and send a check or money order for the correct amount as indicated on the NHC fee schedule. Make it payable to the Department of the Navy, to the Operational Archives, and send it in. How about that? Supposedly, folks, the crew of the civilian merchant ship SS Andrew Ferusa observed the arrival via teleportation of the Eldridge into the Norfolk area. Andrew Ferusa, this is a hard, I've never been able to pronounce it, is spelled F-U-R-U-S-E-T-H apostrophe S. Ferusa's movement report cards are in the 10th Fleet records transferred to the Textual Reference Branch, National Archives and Records Administration, 8601 Adelphi Road, College Park, Maryland, 20740-6001. The cards list the ship's ports of call, the dates of the visit, and convoy designation, if any. The movement report card shows that Andrew Ferusa left Norfolk with convoy UGS-15 on the 16th of August, 1943, and arrived at Casablanca on the 2nd of September. The ship then left Casablanca on the 19th of September and arrived off of Cape Henry on the 4th of October. Andrew Ferusa left Norfolk with convoy UGS-22 on the 25th of October and arrived at Oran on 12 November. That's the 12th of November. The ship remained in the Mediterranean until it returned with convoy GUS-25 to Hampton Roads on 17 January 1944. The archives has a letter from Lieutenant Junior Grade William S. Dodge, United States Navy Reserve, retired, who was the master of Andrew Ferusa in 1943, categorically denying that he or his crew observed any unusual event while in Norfolk. Eldridge and Andrew Ferusa were not even in Norfolk at the same time ever. The Office of Naval Research, which is the ONR, has stated that the use of force fields to make a ship and her crew invisible does not conform to known physical laws. The Office of Naval Research also claims that Dr. Albert Einstein's unified field theory was never completed. During 1943 and 1944, Einstein was a part-time consultant with the Navy's Bureau of Ordnance, undertaking a theoretical research on explosives and explosions. There is no indication that Einstein was involved in research relevant to invisibility or to teleportation. The Office of Naval Research's information sheet on the Philadelphia experiment can be obtained, ladies and gentlemen. The Philadelphia experiment has also been called Project Rainbow. A comprehensive search of the archives has failed to identify any records of a Project Rainbow relating to teleportation or making a ship disappear. In the 1940s, the codename Rainbow was used to refer to the Rome-Berlin-Tokyo axis. The Rainbow plans were the war plans to defeat Italy, Germany, and Japan. Rainbow 5, with a Roman numeral V, the plan in effect on 7 December 1941 when Japan attacked Pearl Harbor, was the plan the U.S. used to fight the Axis powers. Now, some researchers have erroneously concluded that degaussing has a connection with making an object invisible. I can assure you and everybody who's ever sailed on a Navy ship that has degaussing on board, and the degaussing is always used, ladies and gentlemen, can assure you that no such thing has ever happened or can happen. Degaussing is merely a process in which a system of electrical cables are installed around the circumference of a ship's hull, running from bow to stern on both sides and athwart ships, which is around the circumference of the ship, usually somewhere near the center of the ship, where a measured electrical current is passed through these cables to cancel out the ship's magnetic field. That's all it is. Degaussing equipment was installed in the hull of Navy ships and could be turned on whenever the ship was in waters that might contain magnetic mines, usually shallow waters and combat areas. It could be said that degaussing correctly done makes a ship invisible to the sensors of magnetic mines, but to nothing and to no one else. You see, the ship always remains visible to the human eye. It remains in the time and in the geographical area where it always was when the degaussing was turned on. Radar can still detect it, and underwater listening devices can still hear it. I have searched for many years for any substantiation of any of this. There isn't any. It cannot possibly be true. It is fake, phony. It is a lie. After many years of searching, no one has been able to find any proof whatsoever that any of it ever happened. The staff of the operational archives and independent researchers have not located any official documents that support the assertion that an invisibility or teleportation experiment involving a Navy ship ever occurred at Philadelphia or any other location, ladies and gentlemen. I hate to say this, but you've all of you that believe in this stuff, that is, have been taken for a ride, and it's your own fault. You never check anything. You never do any research, no investigation. You just believe it. Why do you believe it? That's what I want to know. Is it because you want so much to believe it that you want it to be true? And if you do, why? I mean, what is the advantage in wanting that to be true, especially with the more macabre and gruesome aspects that are supposedly connected with this thing? Why is it that you all think that there is something, you know, that needs to be true about all of this? I can't figure it out. Can't figure you out. Doesn't make sense. Isn't the world interesting enough without having to invent all the... I find that that reality is much more interesting and strange and scary than inventing all of these things that are not true. We're going to examine more of these things, and I'm going to pin some hoaxers to the wall on one of these more recent efforts of these people. Yes, I am, and you're going to hear it. And a lot of you are going to like it. And all of you Looney Tune, wacko, woo-woo people who are always writing me nasty letters because I'm popping your bubbles, get your pen and paper ready, because you got a whole bunch more to write. Because I'm not only going to pop them, I'm going to wrap them up in nice, shining paper and stick them right in your ear.
There's an old piano and they play it hot behind the green door. don't know what they're doing, but they laugh a lot behind the green door. Wish they let me in so I could find out what's behind the green door.
Not once, twice, you can't imagine there. Doors slam, hospitality's been there. Wonder just what's going on in there.
Saw an eyeball peeping through a smoky cloud behind the green door. When I said no, sent me someone laughed out loud behind the green door. All I want to do is join the happy crowd behind the green door.
Green door. What's the secret behind the green door? Well, you know that at one time there was a green door in the Pentagon. In fact, in most military buildings, inside, there was a sort of a green and white paint theme, and in fact, all of the doors were green. And yes, in the Pentagon, and in the headquarters of the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet, and in the headquarters of the Commander-in-Chief of the Atlantic Fleet, and headquarters of the United States Army, Europe, there are secrets. Quite a few, as a matter of fact. None of them have anything to do with extraterrestrials whatsoever. Or with invisibility experiments, or making ships or airplanes vanish, or sending them forward or backward in time, or anything else. None of them. And there are just as many new hoaxes and lies and scams coming out now as, in fact, more than there ever have been in the past. Many more. Remember all the Gulf Breeze photos? Remember all of those photographs of the extraterrestrial spacecraft supposedly visiting Gulf Breeze and abducting people? Well, guess what? If you go to the mayor's house in Gulf Breeze and look in his backyard, you'll find that there are these paper lanterns, or there used to be. They're probably not there now. But in his yard, he had paper lanterns. You know, like Chinese paper lanterns, Japanese lanterns. And I guess it was for summer night barbecues or something like that. And if you take one of those lanterns, it is exactly what was displayed in the photographs of the so-called Gulf Breeze extraterrestrial UFO visitation ships. All fake. All phony. Every one of them. In fact, most so-called photographs of UFOs or flying saucers have been proven over the years to be obvious fakes. I'll never forget, I went to a UFO thing down in Phoenix one time at a hotel, and was introduced to a very famous figure in the ufology movement, Colonel Wendell Stevens. And he had a booth there, a table set up. And he had his latest photograph of the latest genuine UFO extraterrestrial craft from some other planet that was here flying around in our atmosphere. I couldn't help it, folks. I fell to the floor laughing. I could not control my laughter. It just took over, because there, in a 16 by 20 inch photograph, was a picture of a jellyfish in the ocean. And he was claiming to all of the people there that this was an extraterrestrial spacecraft photographed in our atmosphere. Well, he didn't know that for a good portion of my life I was a diver, a deep sea diver, a commercial diver, a scuba diver, a hard hat diver. I even taught diving at the most prestigious diving college in the world, the College of Oceaneering in Wilmington, California. I taught the mixed gas deep saturation course. I taught underwater demolition. I taught a lot of things, because I've spent a lot of years and a lot of hours underwater. And I've seen an awful lot of jellyfish, ladies and gentlemen. And that was a jellyfish that somebody photographed underwater in the blue ocean. And Wendell Stevens was presenting it to the world as an extraterrestrial spacecraft, here carrying visitors from other lands far, far away across the universe. And this man is a retired Air Force colonel. Many people believe him just because of that. What is it about people that makes them fall for such nonsense? I've studied for many hours the Billy Meyer photographs from Switzerland. The first thing I found out about Billy Meyer when I studied his history and his politics and his character is that he's a communist. Billy Myers is a communist, admitted communist. That was a strike against him to begin with. Then when we began studying his photographs and we found things hanging from strings, that sort of made us chuckle. Then when we found a very famous UFO photograph that he had put out and compared it to the lights in his garage and found out it was the exact same thing, I mean, that really made us laugh. And then when we looked at his motion picture footage and saw that the D-Max and the emulsion obviously changes as these craft enter and leave the picture. It's a very, very simple jump from there to taking a motion picture of a pastoral background and then just laying over it another film that has a chroma background with these craft in it, hanging from a string again, dancing all over the universe, and re-photographing them together. And that's exactly what was done. They say, well, this couldn't possibly have happened because he puts fresh film in his camera every time. Oh, you poor dummies. It's easy for it all to be done somewhere else, put in a fresh film wrapper and given to Billy Meyer so that he can take out the wrapper and undo it in front of you and put it in his motion picture camera and set the aperture down so low that he's really not taking a picture of anything, and then send it off to be processed. You're so gullible. Absolutely gullible that it is pathetic. You know, I've often sat down and thought to myself, you know, I know how to make millions off of these people. All I have to do is give them what they want. And it's so easy to manufacture these hoaxes and tell people exactly what they want to hear and make them feel good. That's what Anthony Robbins does. There's no secret to what he does. He doesn't know anything any more than anybody else in the world. He gets up in front of you and charges you exorbitant amounts of money to tell you exactly what you want to hear. And as long as he does that, you will continue forking shovel loads of money into his pockets. And I think it's great. Only my conscience won't let me do it, so I'm never going to get rich off of you guys. I just can't do it. I wouldn't be able to. You know, I'd get up there and I'd talk for about 10 minutes and I'd be telling you all these things. All of a sudden I would burst out laughing and that would be the end of my career. Because I wouldn't be able to stop. I couldn't stop myself from laughing. I ain't Chihuahua. But you know what, guys? You deserve it. You asked for it. You're getting what you asked for, so I don't see how in the world you could complain. It's impossible to complain about something that you asked for in the first place, don't you think? I think so. Check it out. You know, what goes around comes around in the circle of life.
Thank you.
This is the voice of freedom. Freedom of the body and of the soul and of the mind. Listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network, with studios in Eager, Arizona, broadcasting on satellite GE1, transponder 7, 7.56 audio, and over 700 FM stations across the nation and around the world. The Hour of the Time is also carried on WRMI, Worldwide Shortwave Radio, 99.55 kilohertz, Monday through Friday nights, from 5 until 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Hour of the Time. We are roasting the hoaxers today. We are laying bare the blathering BS that has been occupying a lot of your attention instead of devoting your attention to what you should be devoting it to. Instead of paying attention to what's happening to your country and to your world, you are out chasing your tails like a bunch of little children on Halloween. And you're going to have a lot of explaining to do after this. And you should. You should have an awful lot of explaining to do to an awful lot of people who you've been leading astray and who've been leading themselves astray. The world today is full of lies and deception. We can no longer believe what anybody tells us. I don't care who they are. Not even our own mothers. Because about half of the things that they tell us are also fantasies that they were taught when they were young, or that they got into because they didn't investigate anything. And don't write me a letter telling me not to pick on your mother. I said mothers, which includes mine. But I'm not picking on mothers. I'm just telling you the truth. Ladies and gentlemen, the truth is we're stuck running around in fantasy land. Like the three monkeys. Only it's hear no truth, see no truth, speak no truth. That's really what's going on there. It really is. And an awful lot of other things, ladies and gentlemen. We're lost in la-la land, many of us. Others are trying to find our way in reality. And if we can, we're going to bring you out of that that theme park that you're stuck in and make you face the hookers out there on Anaheim Boulevard.
Well, I saw the thing coming out of the sky, but a one long horn and one big eye. I saw Mr. Chicken in the city. It looked like a purple people eater to me. It was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looked strange to me.
One-eyed.
When he came down to earth and he lit in the tree, I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, don't eat me. I heard him say in a voice so gruff, it was a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater.
One-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. Sure looks strange to me. I said, Mr. Purple People Eater, what's your line? He said, eating purple people, and it sure is fine. But that's not the reason that I came to land. Well, just my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater, pigeon toed undercoat, flying purple people eater, friendly little people eater, what a sight to see. And then he swung from the tree and he lit on the ground and he started to rock, but really rocking around. It was a crazy kitty with a swing and swing. Well, that's my soul, rock and roll, flying purple people eater, pigeon toed undercoat, flying purple people eater. What a sight to see. Really went on his way, and then what do you know? I saw him last night on a TV show. He was blowing it out, really knocking him dead. Play rock and roll music through the horn in his head.
That's that's what by choice aliens drink, by choice tequila, and probably a lot of the people who believe in them. Oh boy. Well, gee, what are some of the most recent things that are going on here? Well, let me give you some of them. And I just got so many here, I don't even know where to start. It's amazing. Let me see if I can find it here. Oh, yes. Well, I've misplaced that one, but I've got so many, it doesn't matter. I can just read these things all day and all night if I want to. Here's one. October 30th, 1996. On the Gordon Elliott Show, Fox Network, Jack Kasher, Ph.D., doesn't say what his Ph.D. is in, it's probably Looney Tunology, was revealing his views that the NASA STS footage showing a beam coming up from the Earth and an object pulling a right-angle turn at more than an estimated 100 Gs was an advanced, intelligently controlled spacecraft and not a particle of ice, as NASA claims. Due to the fact that the broadcast was caught already in progress, we were unable to note where Dr. Kasher works, but the tone of the conversation implied that he worked with NASA, and NASA says that they don't know the guy. How about that? Well, let me tell you what that was about, folks. There was, if any of you who watch the NASA channel, you see the beautiful color photography from the space shuttle. And they just keep that going all the time. The space shuttle obviously just has a camera on, just pointed out there. And it's always in beautiful color. Just absolutely beautiful color. All of the images are crisp and and just some of the best photography with some of the best technology that you've ever seen. It's beautiful. Well, all of a sudden on this day, see, we're going along looking at the beautiful NASA color photography and everything was clear and crisp. All of a sudden, the whole image changed. The color photography shut off and it was replaced with black and white, and everything was sort of fuzzy, out of focus. And then you see this white thing go across the screen, and you see this other white thing come up and go past it, and then you see it do a right angle turn and it's gone. And what it looked like was somebody playing with Photoshop on a computer. That's really what it looked like. And then the beautiful color pictures came back, and all in focus, and everything was nice. Well, we had, there's more than just people watching the NASA channel. There are people who monitor these signals, where they come from and where they go. And people who were monitoring this on that day, and I'm talking about space nuts who are electronic geniuses, say that that signal did not come from the space shuttle, ladies and gentlemen, but from a CIA facility in Virginia, which they were able to pinpoint by triangulation, and that it wasn't photography from the space shuttle at all. Well, all these wackos jumped on board, and the next thing we saw was Donald Francis Ecker III on television being interviewed about this, and the commentators asked him whether it could be fake or not. He says, fake, and then it's bleeped out because he used an expletive there. He said, fake, blank, my blank, this is an extraterrestrial craft. Donald Francis Ecker III is the so-called research director for UFO Magazine, which has a history that is just incredible. UFO Magazine is owned by Vicki Cooper, no relation to me whatsoever. Vicki Cooper used to be a high-class, highly paid hooker who worked for Sidney Biddle Barrows, the Mayflower Madam. Well, apparently the Mayflower Madam operation stepped on somebody's toes because their clientele were diplomats and rich, wealthy people and Hollywood stars and all of this kind of thing for their little call girl ring there. Well, the feds entrapped Vicki somehow. That has never come to light yet. And Vicki turned state's evidence against the Mayflower Madam, her boss, and her fellow hookers. And they put her in the witness protection program, gave her some money, and sent her to Los Angeles to start UFO Magazine. Well, Vicki had never heard of UFOs, didn't know anything about UFOs, didn't want anything to do with UFOs. When she got to Los Angeles, she was met there by Barry Taff. Barry Taff has worked extensively for the neuropsychiatric... the neuropsychiatric laboratory of the University of Southern California, Los Angeles, UCLA, very closely with Dr. Louis Jolyon West, the premier mind control manipulator of the intelligence community in the United States government. Well, Vicki had never known him before in her life, but she was met at the airport by Barry Taff, who then installed her in an apartment just over his own apartment. Vicki made no secret of the fact that she didn't like UFOs, didn't care about UFOs, didn't want anything to do with UFOs, didn't really want to have a UFO magazine, but the CIA had financed UFO magazine, and it was part of her condition of staying out of jail, so she did it. And she told everybody, that everybody in the UFO field, all of these ufologists, she told them, are CIA agents, and that the CIA was financing her magazine. Made no secret of it whatsoever. There's lots of people who heard her say this and who have relayed that story to us. I documented it in my book and named two of the people who heard her say it. Don't want to name them all. They might disappear. Well, Donald Francis Ecker is now the research director for UFO Magazine. After being there for a while, he married Vicki Cooper, so now it's a husband and wife team. We investigated Donald Francis Ecker's background because most of what he has written and what he does and what he puts out is not just questionable, it's just downright phony, fake lies. Well, Donald Francis Ecker has told the world that his qualifications for being the research director and for being believed on the subject of UFOs is that he was a police officer and a criminal investigator for many police departments and state law enforcement agencies across the United States, and he has named many of them, Philadelphia being one, Boise, Idaho being another. Well, we simply just went and checked their personnel records and told them that he had applied to us for a job and asked, you know, for some kind of a recommendation from them. Lo and behold, every single one.